morning. Good afternoon. This is the forum, and I'm Barry Friedman. I'm a little time warped from staying up too late watching the election returns, which reminds me that I want to make an announcement about the forum schedule and about what's ahead. So first, we've swapped the forum schedule for a variety of reasons, and I hope you'll let everyone that you know. So next week, we are not going to be doing what we said we were going to do, but we're going to be doing the program on how to study for and take law school exams. So let all the first years you know and all the LLM students you know that we're going to do that. And I'm actually not going to be on the program. Sam Zakharoff is going to do that with a couple of students. Then the following week, we're actually going to have a panel related to the election on the question of gridlock in Congress and what can be done about it and what are the problems and what are the possible solutions. And that will be on the 17th, and that will be our final forum of the week. So we're having a first for the forum, which is that we're short, as you can see, one of our speakers. We once before had a speaker who got stranded on a runway and didn't make it, but I knew that at least a couple of hours in advance. This time I'm missing a speaker unless he happens to walk in the room. So I'm going to introduce the speakers that we do have. I'm going to then sit here in the back of my mind and think about how I'm going to play that role, which at least I have a little competence to do, and we'll proceed. The topic is the New York stop and frisk policy. It's a topic that's very timely. It's been in the news constantly, but I'll point out that it's also an issue that transcends New York and that is an issue in many places in the country. We have a terrific panel to discuss it. To my right is Andy Schaefer. So Andy, I first got to know in two capacities, the general counsel of the university, but also teaches criminal procedure and has taught criminal procedure here for a long time and is a wildly popular teacher. During the time from when I met Andy, he moved to the NYPD and is the deputy commissioner for legal affairs. He's going to have a disclaimer, which I'll make for him as well, which is that he's here in his professorial capacity. As people point out to me all the time, the NYPD usually is not on panels like this, but it isn't on this panel. We just have Professor Schaefer here, and I'm really delighted that he's here. To my left, so I guess everybody's sitting ideologically in the wrong seats, at least as far as I'm concerned, but maybe not you, is Heather McDonald. Heather's here from the Manhattan Institute, which is a conservative think tank. She clerked for Judge Reinhardt. She writes on many issues involving law enforcement. In fact, my students are reading a lot of her work this semester, and I think she's got a very wonderful way of thinking about things. And finally, if Dennis makes it, I'll introduce him, and if not, I'll be playing Dennis Parker. So the way we go is we're going to go, I think we'll go maybe you, me, Heather, then we'll stop and have the usual questions. Thanks,
good morning, good afternoon, everybody. I want to repeat the disclaimer. My role here today is only as a member of the teaching faculty here at the university and at the law school, and I'm not a spokesman for the NYPD on these or other issues. So what I'm saying are my views and not those attributable to the NYPD or anybody else employed by the NYPD. Having said that, I view my role in starting out as ultimately one of issue framing, and let me do it in the following way. It seems to me that the public debate about stop and frisk in New York City has centered around one or more of the following four statements or allegations. One, are police conducting stops and frisks without proper legal justification? Two, are police disproportionately stopping and frisking minorities? Three, are police using different standards in deciding whether to stop and frisk minorities versus others? And fourth, are the police simply conducting too many stops and frisks? It seems to me the debate has surrounded is constantly on those four or a subset of those four questions. So first, legal standard. Now, I'm looking around the room. I don't know whether all of the students here have or will have had a course in criminal procedure law. So what I want to do to start out is make eight quick statements of law governing this area. And this will be familiar to people. I see people around the room who are in my class and were in my class last year, and you'll be tested again. But in any event, I want to make the following eight statements of law. First, the constitutional basis for stop and frisk was, amazingly, not established until 1968, but it was established in 1968 in Terry against Ohio. And this 8-1 decision by Chief Justice Earl Warren, with only Justice Douglas dissenting, was an extraordinary one because it permitted seizures of the person, which we call stops, and searches of the person, which we call frisks, on less than probable cause. There is no more revolutionary development in all of Fourth Amendment jurisprudence than that. And that was the ground on which Justice Douglas dissented, saying you can't do these things which look like arrests, seizures of the person and seizures of the person and searches for evidence can only be done on probable cause. But he was in the minority of one. It was an 8-1 decision. The opinion tells us that stops may be done not on probable cause. This is my third point of eight. Stops could be done on reasonable suspicion that crime is afoot. And that's later elongated into three propositions. Crime is being committed, is about to be committed, or as later extended, has been committed, at least with respect to felonies or other crimes of violence. Fourth, stops may be accomplished by the use of force. It's not a consensual event, and it's very, very clear in Terry, both in, and especially in Harlan's and White's concurring opinions, that force may be used to effectuate a stop. Fifth, frisks may be done on reasonable suspicion that the person stopped, in the words of Terry, was armed and dangerous. And that's really been extended to danger. Sixth, persons stopped are not obliged to answer questions, and their refusal to do so doesn't elevate reasonable suspicion to probable cause. Seventh, persons stopped may be temporarily detained against their will while the police dispel or confirm their suspicion. So it's important to note force may be used, and a person may be detained against his or her will for a certain amount of time. The last legal point has some sub points. So doctrinally, we're advised that reasonable suspicion is a standard of certainty less than probable cause, itself not mathematical. And the standard for probable cause to make a full-blown custodial arrest under federal standards is less than a preponderance. Probable cause under federal standards is less than a preponderance. Under New York law, it is a preponderance. That's for the higher standard, probable cause, and reasonable suspicion is a lower standard of certainty. Articulated in Gates against Illinois in 1984 as a fair probability. That's the standard for probable cause. Okay. So with that 8 point, and maybe I made it 9 or 10, with those points of legal background, I'd like to now turn. So do police stop individuals without reasonable suspicion? Surely the answer is sometimes, and we see decisions both in state and federal courts so holding, and thereby suppressing evidence obtained in a subsequent frisk. As I like to say in class, the hard questions you should always ask, always, sometimes, never. And with respect to stops without reasonable suspicion, it's surely sometimes. Next question, is there, quote, a policy of making stops without reasonable suspicion? A policy. Well, the published policy of the New York City Police Department is found in the Patrol Guide 212-11, promulgated on July 18th, 03. And if you look at the patrol guide, I have it with me, but I won't read it. It accurately tracks the law as I've recited it in the last 5 minutes. The patrol guide accurately tracks the law as to when a stop and or a frisk are legally permitted. So I don't think the issue is one of policy. I think the issue ultimately is one of practice. The question then is there a widespread practice of stops without reasonable suspicion? So that's the question we've come to as the first question. And this is a key claim of the plaintiffs in the current litigation regarding stop and frisk in New York. So a word about that litigation now. It's pending here in Manhattan in the in federal court before Judge Shindlin. It's called Floyd against the City of New York, 08 Civ 1034. And I see in the room a very well-regarded scholar who's the plaintiff's expert, Jeffrey Fagan, sitting in the back of the room from Columbia, visiting here at NYU this year. And he's now completed his expert report for the plaintiffs. There was the reply to his expert report will be done by Professor Dennis Smith at NYU's Wagner School. Dennis, I also saw come in shortly before we began, and they will be the competing experts in the case. Professor Smith will have to reply by November 15th, and then after that there will be fact discovery has closed, and there will be depositions of the experts. Simultaneously, Judge Shindlin has set a summary judgment schedule, and the arguments, the written preparations on summary judgment will be fully submitted by mid January, if not further extended. So, in the New York Times last week, I had a synopsis of some of Professor Fagan's findings, that article appeared on, I think, 1027. And one of the conclusions of the article, or one of the observations of the article on page 822 of the Times, an article by Al Baker and Ray Rivera for the Times, in a subset of cases, Professor Fagan reported, or the New York Times reported that Professor Fagan reported, Professor Fagan, I've not read your report yet, but the Times reported that in a subset of stops, that in 6.7%, the piece of paper filled out by the police after the event, called a 250, on its face did not show reasonable suspicion in 6.7% of a subset of cases. There'll be expert arguments on whether the denominator of that fraction is correct or not, but I won't pause on that. The article then added, and I'm assuming quoting correctly from Professor Fagan's study, that another 24% of stops did not have enough information on the form to figure out whether or not there was reasonable suspicion. Couldn't tell. So the top line number of 6.7% is roughly 1 out of 16. Okay. So quantify or putting in that context of Professor Fagan's argument, I assume for the plaintiffs, will be that there is a widespread, or at least a numerical practice, which will follow his data. And Dennis Smith will reply to that, and I'm not going to further comment on the expert report. Oh, time is an issue. I have to speed up. Sorry. Quickly now. I said there were four issues. I've only done one. Let me quickly do the other three. Disproportionality, that minorities are disproportionately stopped. It seems to me the question is disproportional to what? Disproportional to what? Much public discussion has focused on census data. Few scholars would choose that standard. Men, after all, constitute 50% of the population, but 99% of all stops. Is there gender discrimination? It seems to me that what we're looking for is what is the expected distribution by race or any other category? What's the expected distribution of stops? And we approach that question, or at least the published articles approach that question, in two ways. Published police department statistics ask that question by, what we're trying to figure out is, it seems to me in a generic sense, is does the population that is stopped and frisked accurately reflect what? What should we be seeking to measure? And it seems to me generically what we're seeking to measure is whether that lines up with the population which is committing street crime rather than census data. And the way that articles have tried to get at the issue is by looking at the race of the perpetrator as reported by the victim of street crime. So that's one way. And another is by the race of those who were arrested. And in those ways, an attempt is made to approximate, or the argument goes, that's the way to begin to approximate what proportionality ought to be. Too much of the public discussion is only about census data, and I don't know any scholars who believe that that's the proper yardstick. Quickly now, different standards. Are police arresting, stopping minorities by applying a different standard of reasonable suspicion? It seems to me the way to get at that is what some of the articles call the hit rate. And so if you look at stops of minorities and non-minorities, is the subsequent history, are they arrested or not, the same for minorities and non-minorities? And if those hit rates are close to one another, then one can infer that different standards are not being applied. And finally, the last point, are there too many stops? And so assume for a moment that all of the stops being conducted are based on reasonable suspicion. Just assume that for a moment. What's too many? If there's no equal protection issue, if there's no true disproportionality, what makes too many? And it seems to me the only way to get at that question will begin to look at the question of effectiveness. And so I'll end with two more points quickly. Effectiveness. Professor Smith has published articles saying that stops and frisks are effective in reducing crime in New York. Professor Zimring, who is about to come out with his book called The City That Became Safe, has looked at the question of police tactics, and in a presentation here a few weeks ago in this room at the Criminal Justice Colloquium, he concluded that the drop in crime in New York, unprecedented in the annals of urban crime in the United States or elsewhere, that the very substantial drop in crime in substantial part was attributable to what he called police effect. Within police effect, he observed large increases in the hiring of police, more manpower, and putting police into impact zones where crime rates are high. He concluded that those were the tactics which most significantly contributed to police effect in reducing crime in New York. On stops and frisks, he said that his opinion was the data was not conclusive. So I'll end there with my preamble and turn it over to Barry.
Thanks, Andy. So I'm happy to introduce Dennis Parker. Dennis was the chief of the Civil Rights Bureau in Elliot Spitzer's Attorney General's office, and since 2006 has been the director of the ACLU's Racial Justice Program. And Dennis, you have the mic.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here, and let me apologize for being late. I was tempted to say that I was stopped by the police, but that wouldn't be correct. In fact, I made the mistake of relying too much on Hopstop's estimate of how long it would take to get from 125 Broad Street to here. Let me start with the statistics, as I think the discussion starts there, but doesn't end there, and I think it's a significant thing in the discussion we're going to be having going forward about the fundamental question is, number one, whether the stops are effective in assuring safety for the whole community, and whether they're constitutional and fair. And the two are not unrelated, and I think that the statistics only start to tell the story of some of the concerns and some of the problems. And again, I missed the beginning, so that I don't know how much of this was gone over.
All that Andy talked about was some of the basic Terry law.
Okay.
And though one might quibble a little bit with it, I think it was close enough for teaching at NYU, and so I think we're okay.
Well, what I'd like to do is to provide as a background some of the numbers that at least have sparked the discussions and sparked the Floyd case. And number one is the enormous increase in the numbers of cases where people were stopped and questioned and or frisked. In 1992, it was fewer than 100,000. By this year, it will be certainly well over 500,000, so that it has increased exponentially. 87% of the people who were stopped and frisked are people of color. And the hit rate that was discussed before is also significant. Of the people who were stopped, of African Americans, 1.6% of them were arrested, 1.5% of Latinos, and interestingly, 2.2% of whites. One of the reasons that is forwarded for the aggressive policies that we're discussing now is the question of reducing weapons. And in that area, 1.1% of African Americans who were stopped and frisked, and I'll say that rather than stopped and frisked and questioned, but you should assume and questioned is added on. For Latinos, it's 1.4%, and for whites, it's 1.7%. But if you look at gun use, that number is below 1%. So a very small percentage of the people who are stopped and frisked are found to have a weapon, the main reason.
Can I just interrupt with a question? For you or Andy, it's just a data question, but I think it would help. Do we know the percentage of the people that are stopped, how many are frisked? Is it the same number or is it a lesser number?
I don't know the exact number of how many are frisked and how many are frisked and questioned, but there is also a significant disparity.
I think it's about 50%.
Okay, thank you.
What is different, though, is the way that people are treated after they are stopped, and whites are far less likely to be frisked than are African Americans and Latinos, which is one of the other reasons for concern. One of the things below those statistics that go to our proportions that raise serious questions, there are significant statistical differences between the people where force is used. Not surprisingly, force is used disproportionately with African Americans and Latinos. These things all raise questions. That stop rate and the numbers lead us to question whether or not this is necessary. It is clear that there has been a reduction in crime over the past 20 years in New York City. That reduction started prior to this policy, and it is far less clear the extent to which the stop and frisk policies have had an effect on the crime rate. And if you look at graphs of the crime rate and the incidence of stops, there's no clear correlation between the two. What is clear is that African Americans are more likely to be stopped regardless of the crime rate in the area where they're stopped. One of the arguments for use of more aggressive policies is that, in fact, African Americans and Latinos commit more of the crimes. But a small percentage of those stops and frisks are based on a description of a particular perpetrator. There tend to be, the overwhelming majority are based on much more subjective determinations by the police about suspicious behavior, things like that. And given that, in combination with the low hit rate, it raises questions of the extent to which discrimination is a factor in what we're seeing. But the most important thing that the statistics don't tell is the effect of this policy, the effect of a policy where a large proportion in some of the neighborhoods, as reported in the New York Times, 94%, at least by numbers, of the people who lived in these neighborhoods are stopped. And although that is dismissed by many people as being an inconvenience, the fact is that there is a serious consequence both to the individual and to the perception of law enforcement and society. There is an effect of having an individual stopped repeatedly questioned and searched. It's not just something you can shrug off, and if you've ever had the experience of having gone through it and being suspected of it, then you would recognize that it's not something that you can casually dismiss. It has an effect on a neighborhood. There are suggestions that one of the downsides of keeping records such as this is that it increases the tensions between the police and communities of color. But I'd suggest that is an extremely naive suggestion. The suggestion that suspicion by people of color, by of of misconduct by a police, that it began with the publication of these figures, is just completely contrary to fact and extremely naive. There are suggestions that the people who are furthering these questions, bringing these lawsuits, are actually disserving communities of color, because those communities are concerned with safety, and presumably, I assume it would be argued, are willing to give up their basic constitutional rights to ensure safety. But I have difficulty accepting that. I have difficulty accepting that because if you look at the rate of complaints that are made to the Civilian Complaint Review Board, they are far higher for people of color, which suggests that there are both problems and that there is dissatisfaction with that problem. I hope to, and I assume that I'm getting near the end of my time. Yes, time is an issue. So let me just end by saying that I look forward to a discussion, to an open discussion of the costs and the benefits of this practice, and a hope that we can arrive at some sort of system that will both assure safety for all people while respecting the fundamental constitutional rights of everyone.
Thank you very much, Dennis. Heather.
Thank you, and thank you so much, Professor Friedman, for inviting me to the forum. This is a great honor, and it's also an honor to be with my co-panelists, Mr. Parker and Professor Schaefer. It's a great, great experience. I completely agree with Mr. Parker that there is a possible cost to proactive policing. There is always a risk of stopping people that are completely innocent. And I think the police have to do a far better job of explaining to somebody who has been stopped where there proves to be no ground for arrest or further inquiry, why that stop was made. But I think that against that cost, we have to balance the extraordinary benefits that has come about through proactive, what I'll call compstat policing. And I just want to sort of lay the picture of how radical a thing it is that New York has done, and how extraordinary the police department is in this city, because I think we take it for granted. When William Bratton took over the NYPD in 94, he announced that he would lower crime by 10% in his first year. No police chief in living memory had ever made such a pledge. It signaled Bratton's total break with the reigning ideology about crime, criminology, and policing, which was that the police could not affect crime rates. They could merely respond after the fact. Bratton said, I'm rejecting that. The police are going to take responsibility and hold me accountable for lowering crime. He not only met the 10% pledge, he bested it by 2%. The next year, he upped the ante. He said, I'm going to lower crime by 15%. He lowered it by 16%. In the 1990s, the New York City crime drop drove the national crime drop. It was twice as much as in the rest of the country. And then the 2000s, where other cities that had had significant crime drops flattened out or the crime started going up, New York's crime rate continued to drop. There is no city in this country with such a record. And the primary beneficiaries of this proactive policing have been inner city community residents. 10,000 minority males are alive today who would have been dead had crime rates remained at their early 1990s level. Professor Parker is correct. There was a slight fall off from the high of the homicides of 1990, which was 2260. But the slight fall off had nothing to do with the nosedive that started in 94 when Bratton developed this concept of compstat. Now, if you go downtown to the police headquarters and you go to a compstat meeting, which is held weekly, you are not going to hear anything about race. What you're going to hear is a fanatical, obsessive attention to crime rates. Crime drives everything that the police do in the compstat era. Data from victims. Victim reports are gathered on a daily basis and analyzed to an excruciating degree to try and determine where patterns are starting to break out. That's the name of the game, finding crime patterns, because if you can stop a pattern, you can have a massive effect on crime. And police are deployed where crime is highest. And crime is highest in minority neighborhoods. That's where people are being victimized, and that's why police are being deployed there in the most high amounts and where they're making the most proactive stops. If there's been, let's say, a rash of robberies from ATMs in the East Village, and the police see a bunch of youths watching somebody, an elderly man, take out some cash from an ATM, and then when they see the cop, they turn around and walk away very fast, it's likely that they will be stopped and questioned. Because what the police are trying to do is intervene in crime before it happens. If there's been a string of robberies of elderly senior citizens in East Flatbush, and the police see somebody following an elderly lady very closely and looking over his shoulder, furtive movements is the term in the 250 forms, there's a chance that that person is going to be stopped. Whether there's actual contraband found on that person, grounds for arrest, maybe not, especially in the elaborate choreography of drug dealing. The dealers have it down, so it's very hard to find actual evidence for making a stop. The fact that somebody is not arrested after a reasonable suspicion stop does not mean, A, that the person was not actually involved in casing a victim or suspect, and it certainly doesn't mean that that stop was not legally justified. Nevertheless, as Mr. Park is correct to point out, there are people stopped who are innocent. Again, it doesn't mean that the stop was not legally justified. Mr. Parker mentions briefly, in the most generalized of terms, the crime rates. I'm going to have to bring them up quite literally, because you cannot understand the stop rates without understanding the crime rates. And let me give you a rule. Police activity can either go after crime or it can mirror census data. It cannot do both. The per capita rate of shootings in Ocean Hill, Brownsville, Brooklyn is 81 times higher than in Bay Ridge. People living in Ocean Hill, Brownsville, let's just think about this, stand an 81 times greater chance of getting shot than people in Bay Ridge. Now, where do you think the stop rate is considerably higher? It's 15 times higher in Ocean Hill, Brownsville, than it is in Bay Ridge. Why? Because the police are there to stop crime. Blacks in New York City commit 80% of all shootings, though they're 24% of the population. Add Hispanics and you account for 98% of all shootings. Whites are 35% of the population. They commit 1.4% of all shootings. Where do I get this data? Where do the police get the data? From the victims and witnesses of crime themselves. So this is not the police in some biased fashion. This is what victims tell the police. These disparities are true, as Professor Friedman says, this is a national issue across the country. They mean, again, that the police cannot fight crime and save the victims of crime without being disproportionately deployed in minority neighborhoods. Blacks commit 71% of all robberies. Overall, they commit 66% of all violent crime. They are 55% of all stops. So based on their violent crime rate, which is what drives police deployment, the police now have a program called Impact Zones, where they take rookie cops from the academy and place them in the highest crime areas of the city. Those are going to be in the minority neighborhoods because that's where people are being victimized the most. You cannot go after crime and try to save minority lives without having a disparate impact. We can talk about the hit rate is actually identical. 12% of all stops result in a summons or an arrest for whites, blacks, and Hispanics. The frisk rate is about 3 to 4% times higher when you have similarly situated suspects between blacks and whites. I agree that this is an issue that needs to be discussed, but I would argue that the most important benefit that you can bring to inner city communities is the freedom from fear. And when the police go to community meetings, I've been to many community meetings in Harlem and in Brooklyn, and what you hear from those people is, fear three things. We want more cops, we want the dealers off the streets, and we don't want them back the next day. The police cannot respond to those requests for more policing without having more bodies there and making more stops, and that's what's driving policing in the city and the stop rate, I would argue. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So habitually what we would do is we would move to the crowd because the forum is about hearing from everybody. I get the sense just sitting up here that people are chomping at the bit to say some things, and so I'm not sure which way to go. I thought I actually might toss out a couple of questions, but before I do, we have people with microphones. And so let me see where there are hands, questions in the audience. So we've got one question right here. And I see a disembodied hand in the back of the room. And we're going to move the microphone there for the second question in just a moment. When you stand up to ask your questions, please remember to tell us who you are and where you are in school. So let me just ask a couple of questions, if I may. Maybe one that goes to each side of this discussion. So the first question, which I guess goes to Dennis, is how you respond to the argument about the call from minority communities to have aggressive policing in those communities to bring down the crime rates in those particular communities?
There are two things. One is the assumption that in order to get more police protection that you have to engage in unconstitutional practice is a false one. No one from the minority community is saying we want police to come in no matter what the cost. No one is saying that we want our constitutional rights trampled, that we want to be treated as being less citizens than anyone else. No one is saying that, and there is no assumption from the side of the plaintiffs or any of the advocates who were in favor of constitutional conduct by police. We're not saying that police are bad. We're not saying that there aren't steps that they should take. We're not saying that there shouldn't be more police where there's more crime. We're saying that the law should apply to the way that they deal with the communities. I'd also just like to very briefly say that the discussion of violent crime, which is a tiny percentage of the overall crime, I suspect in order to suggest that people of color have a higher propensity to crime in general, is disturbing to me. It is disturbing to suggest that because there are categories of crime that are high minority participation, I will agree to that, but that is not what most of the crime is, and that's not what most of the interventions in these neighborhoods are for. What we see as a result of these expanded policies is that people of color are more likely to be arrested for marijuana offenses, so that you get rates of over 50%, which don't correlate with any indication of what the use is between the races. And just finally, I would like to say that our Professor Fagan did include in his study an analysis of the effect of crime rates, of economics, and concluded that in spite of those things, that there is, that race is a significant factor in what's happening by the police.
So let me ask a question that I think gets to part of what you just said, which Heather or Andy can jump on, which is, one of the pieces of the data that I find most interesting relates to the frisk statistics, not the stop statistics. So for what it's worth, I think you... and I'm not saying that it's wrong, but see greater clarity than I do about the law of when the stop is permitted. I find Terry perplexing on the issue of why the stop is permitted, but Terry very directly speaks to the question of why the frisk is permitted, and the frisk is permitted to protect the safety of the officer or others in the sense that there's a weapon. And so taking, Heather, and thank you for the figure, but 50% of the over 500,000 people that are frisked every year then in the city, it strikes me that the weapon hit rate is astonishingly low. And, you know, I'm willing to, would assume that you cut some slack about the difference between a suspicion of weapons and the weapons actually being there, but the police are finding weapons in a very, very small percentage of the cases, and I'm just curious to hear something about that, the frisk numbers, from either of you.
Just one clarification. When people talk about weapons, let's define what weapons are. One article, one editorial talked about how in a given sample, only 700 guns were recovered. But they didn't say 700 guns, they said 700 weapons. Well, the number for weapons wasn't 700, it was 7,600. The 6,900 being knives, which were also a weapon. And so one of the things we also see in discussions is a less than complete explication of what the data really are. So if you include knives and guns, you're going to get a number which is 11 times higher than guns alone. Now, in terms of how often frisks occur, when you look at the case law under Terry, it is clear, Barry, that the standard originally articulated was armed and dangerous. Terry was a case about people in Cleveland, Ohio, casing a store for an armed robbery, and that's where the weapons were found. And so from the perception of a law enforcement officer, the question that's always going to be on that person's mind is there a reasonable apprehension of danger? And so whatever the numbers are, I believe in the area of frisks, it is predictable that police will worry about their safety. They will worry about it at night, they will worry about it in high crime neighborhoods, and for them the standard, which I think is entirely consistent with Terry, is a reasonable perception of danger to themselves or others, and that will drive frisks. And the percentage of weapons actually recovered as a percentage of all frisks occurring doesn't seem to me to defeat the argument that frisks are occurring when there's a reasonable apprehension of danger.
Good. I'm going to give Heather a moment if she wants one, but I'm going to ask everybody up here to try to be a little more crisp because we want to give everybody out there a chance. Heather, did you want to say something or are you happy for the moment?
No, I'm happy. I would just reassert what Professor Schaefer said, which is and add that the hit rate for weapons is identical between blacks and whites, and it has discouraged people from carrying. Again, the crime rate difference between this city and others is so astounding. Juveniles in Chicago are killed at 4 times the rate of juveniles in New York City, and the victims in Chicago are basically all black and Hispanic. The homicide rate in New York City is 2/5 that of Chicago. Chicago eschews proactive stops. I would agree with Professor Schaefer, there is a significant yield of weapons, but that's not the only reason that the police are making stops. They are trying to intervene in crimes before they happen, and that has had an extraordinary effect on allowing people in minority neighborhoods to walk to the store without getting mugged or worried about getting mugged.
You're first.
Okay. My name is Evelyn Malave. I'm a 1L here at NYU. I actually have a couple questions. The first is, could the panel talk a little bit about what evidence, if any, there is that it's specifically stop and frisk that's primarily driving the drop in crime, or if it isn't other different changes in police tactics or the economy or just other factors? And the other question was, how is the data used? I know that, I think I read that it isn't expunged and or sealed, and so how is the data used and what are the legal issues around that?
Good. I'm going to ask everybody up here to be crisp because I suspect there are lots of questions. Does anybody want to start on either of the two questions?
Well, I would say that stop and frisk is one part of the crime drop. there's no question. You're right to ask, is it, what role does it play? The CompStat policing is about a fanatical attention to data. It is about holding precinct commanders accountable, which is also something that never happened before. At the CompStat meetings, precinct commanders are called into downtown headquarters and grilled ruthlessly about whether they are on top of crime patterns in their precincts and whether they have a strategy. Stop and frisks embodies the idea that the police have the capacity to lower crime before it happens. But the cornerstones of CompStat policing is data analysis and accountability. And the data use, I will allow my colleagues to go on with that, because that's obviously a highly contested issue. I mean, it's used to analyze further crime patterns, but I'll let Andy do that.
There are dozens and dozens of studies on what the relationship is between stops and frisks and crime rates. Professor Smith, as I said, Dennis Smith, is going to be who the city's expert at trial, has written and published in 2007 an article which attributes to stop and frisk practices a significant decrease in crime in New York. More recently, I mentioned before, Professor Zimring, who's one of the leading criminologists in the United States, in his presentation here a few weeks ago, when he talked about the police effect, he distributed a paper which is available. I put it up on Blackboard for my course, and Professor Jacobs, I'm sure we can make it available to anybody who wants it. It's a September 2nd paper, which is a synopsis of his forthcoming book, The City That Became Safe. But Zimring, at page 30 of his presentation here a few weeks ago, made a chart of which elements of policing he thought were the most effective. And at the top of his list, the first were what he called policing hotspots. Second, destruction of public drug markets. Those were his top two, which he called effective. In the category of probably effective, increased manpower, CompStat management and mapping, and gun programs, like gun buyback programs. Not known, aggressive stops and arrests. So he was not persuaded, or at least he hasn't analyzed the data to the point where he believes that stops and frisks are in the same category as those other variables. I think Professor Smith is of a different view, and there's a lot of literature and a lot of different time frames in controlling for one variable or another, but there's a very, very exhaustive literature on this, and it's growing, and with the forthcoming trial, will grow further.
Did I say something? Are you good?
No, I mean, I'm basically good. The fact that there is so much question about whether or not this is an effective strategy, but on the other side, we know that there is such an enormous cost, suggests caution.
Can I see where there are other questions? And then I'm going to move the, somebody's got the mic there. I'm going to move it in the back there, the second mic. Super. You've got a question in the back?
Hi, my name is Patrick. I'm a 2L. And I have questions about, two questions about how we can hold police accountable to the points of law that Professor Schaefer talked about at the beginning of the forum. So if stop and frisk policies create tension between communities of color and the police, I'm wondering how often those communities use the Civilian Complaint Review Board. And I imagine that the increase in complaints doesn't necessarily match the increase in stops in those communities. And then second,
you know, I'm going to intervene. I'm sorry. There's so many hands, and I'm just going to stick you with one question.
It's all part of the same question. I promise that there's
that
a deep
trick.
Consistency. I promise
Go
there's
ahead,
a deep
ask
consistency.
The question. But
of those who are arrested, so many people plea out that the police are rarely cross-examined on trial. So even those who do have contraband may have been illegally stopped. And how do we hold the police accountable to actually following the law?
Just a very quick response. That, as I mentioned, the number of complaints filed by people of color is far higher than for whites, but even that is probably not an accurate reflection of dissatisfaction because of the common belief and knowledge that the Civilian Complaint Review Board is not an effective way of dealing with police misconduct.
Good. So somebody's got the mic over there.
A recent Quinnipiac poll put the minority support for the NYPD and Commissioner Kelly at around 70%. So there's no question that the complaints are more minorities because people, there's many people that file complaints who are totally innocent and were abused. There's the police make mistakes. There's cops out there with attitude problems, and they need to work constantly on courtesy. But let's be honest, there's also people who file complaints out of her sense of wanting to retaliate against the cop who stopped them. Given that the stop rates are disproportionate, the complaint rates are going to be disproportionate as well. There is minority support for policing because a lot of people understand that their neighborhoods are much safer.
Got a mic back there. Can I see where there are questions again in the room? Just in case you wonder what's going on, I'm somewhat privileging the students, but let's move the mic up here, the other mic. Yeah, go ahead.
My name is Tommy. I'm a 2L. One of the surprising points of agreement on this panel is the relevance of the cost-benefit analysis to answering the question. And I just thought I'd ask for some clarification on how that works. So my first question is whether that's asked in a constitutional context or a political context. And second, if I might ask any or all of you to detail the methodology by which you go about comparing cost to benefits when they, on their face, seem somewhat incommensurate. Thanks.
If I could start, I was perhaps making a mistake of having too much of a political discussion. I think the questions are constitutional questions. I think that we recognize that there are times when the only question isn't whether or not you were guilty of a crime, but whether there are larger societal goals that are being served, as is the case with the exclusionary rule. But I think that it's important that people understand that it's not just a question of some you know, people sitting in NYU arguing about theory. It's a question of what the practice is on the street. It is a question of people who feel as if they are not a part of the system, and the people who are plaintiffs in this lawsuit are innocent private citizens who discuss what the effects are. And it makes it that much worse if it's done for a program whose effects are not certain, and actually may not help at all.
Well, Mr. Parker is, of course, correct that this discussion has to move to the political level, we have to have resolved the constitutional level. And I am really debating on the political level on the assumption that the vast majority of stops are constitutional. But that doesn't mean that Mr. Parker isn't correct that there's going to be a cost. And I don't think there's any kind of, you know, economic quantitative analysis methodology for quantifying and measuring this. I would just say, let us, as a political matter, include all of the so-called stakeholders. I hate that word, but sometimes it comes in handy. You know, here's what the police hear. Here's what they're hearing a lot. An elderly resident in a public housing project saying, there's guys in my lobby selling drugs. I want them out of there because it scares me. And the police, to respond to that, they cannot respond to that without generating data that the Center for Constitutional Rights is going to use against them in a lawsuit. They cannot respond to the heartfelt demands that law-abiding residents of inner city New York are bringing to them without generating disproportionate stop data. And so in the cost-benefit analysis, let's remember that there are people that are begging for more police activity and more police protection. And it's how you resolve that, I don't know. But they're out there too. I mean, there's the plaintiffs in Floyd, but there's also the people that are every single month showing up at those precinct community meetings saying we want more activity.
What's the relief being sought in Floyd?
Well, it's both equitable and monetary. They're individual named plaintiffs. Mr. Parker could probably expand on this, but they're individual named plaintiffs. They'll be seeking damages. They will seek class action certification, which is a big legal issue in the case. If there's a class action, then there'll be money sought for a class of persons. They will also seek equitable relief, which raises interesting questions as to what that relief could be. So, for example, were a trial to conclude that there is a practice of stopping people without reasonable suspicion, what are the remedies at the end of that lawsuit? One, I suppose, is more training and such like. But there's also the interesting question, depending upon what the data show, of do we run the risk of converting every contested stop into a federal lawsuit? What's the right forum for the adjudication of claims of stops without reasonable suspicion? Right now, the main forum is in criminal court when a weapon is found and a motion is made to suppress. Another forum is civil litigation. But there really are interesting and difficult questions about whether or not we're going to federalize the litigation of every stop that occurs in the city. I think the federal courts would be loath to do that. But that's what is being sought, and there's some interesting issues of remedy. Mr. Parker, I don't know if you wanted to comment further on remedies.
Actually, I'm not directly involved in the case, so that I would be, I'm not entirely comfortable talking about what the center is going to be looking for in terms of remedies. I would point out that there are deficiencies in the complaint, there are deficiencies in a practice that are the part of the basis for the complaint. For example, that one of the reasons given for stops is that it was in a high crime area, which the Supreme Court has ruled is not a constitutional basis for making a stop. There is information that's missing on a large number of the forms. There are questions about whether or not the forms represent the number of stops, so that I would imagine that part of the relief that will be sought will be more accurate record keeping and a review of those data.
Okay, I've got a mic here, and I've got a woman in the back with an arm up. Yep.
My name is Peter Shuck. I'll be a visiting professor here in the spring. I'm wondering whether there are any opportunities that have not been fully exploited to retain the effectiveness of stop and frisks under the current policy, while reducing some of the tensions that Mr. Parker suggests surround these encounters. Two comments by
talking to the mic. Can you hold it in your hand?
Two comments by panel members suggested that may be the case. Heather mentioned courtesy training, and earlier somebody said that it might be possible to explain the reasons for a stop, so that the person being stopped would at least have some sense that it's perhaps not on illegitimate grounds. Can you say a bit more? Can any of you say a bit more about whether those opportunities have been pursued?
Or I was going to ask precisely the same question. I think it's a great question.
Well, you know, Commissioner Safer had the courtesy, professionalism, and respect campaign that for some reason was widely mocked. I mean, maybe it was because they got the little wallet cards, which isn't really enough. That's not going to make somebody necessarily change their behavior. I think it is stressed in the academy, but it should be stressed at roll calls. Frankly, I mean, it oftentimes it's very hard on cops, you know, which is not to excuse at all discourteous behavior, but they get a lot of harassment on the street, and also they're often in a rush situation, and they do get street hardened. But none of this, I'm describing what is empirically the fact, which isn't to necessarily justify it, but let's not forget that they get airmail thrown at them off of buildings. This is, you know, projectiles thrown off of roofs at them, and get mistreated. The Justice Department has found that the biggest predictor of police behavior is civilian behavior. So that there gets to be sort of a vicious cycle. But I do think that at every opportunity, the police have to stress to cops on the beat that they are there to serve the public and should do so with as much courtesy and respect as possible.
Just to add a footnote to your question, Professor Shuck, I do believe that the CCRB, the Civilian Complaint Review Board here in New York, has started a pilot program of mediation. And some of the early results, I don't have the data, but I know it was started. And the cases which are brought to mediation at least an early observation was a lot of people who file civilian complaints is all they want is an apology or an explanation. And I think the instinct to have more civility, more communication, a remedy other than litigation would always be helpful.
I'm all in favor of civility also. And I think that there needs to be training, but I think that just as it would be wrong to suggest that all police are discriminatory, it is equally wrong to suggest that race and discrimination play no role in police actions, and I think that there has to be accountability. I have to say I'm not overwhelmed when I hear that the CCRB is undertaking mediation as a solution to all of the problems that we're talking about. I think there has to be something where there will be true accountability when there are found to be violations.
Yeah, I have so many questions, so if it's okay. Brief.
I would just, at some point, I would love to hear from either Professor Freeman Parker or anybody else what they think the stop rate should be. I mean, what is the benchmark? And Professor Schaefer raised this in the beginning, which is the problem of the benchmark. And he says that it's in academics, census is viewed as absurd. However, that is what the argument continues to be made, which is the stop rate is compared to the population ratios. Given what crime rates are, I'm just wondering, maybe does Mr. Parker have any sense what you think the stop rate should look like?
Right, I think it's ludicrous to say that there is a certain number that it should be. You know, the statistics are never the end point for these things. In discrimination law, it's something that raises a suspicion, that it creates burdens that shift. It requires greater examination, but no one would say that the difference between 300,000 stops and 300,000 and one stops is the difference between legal and illegal conduct. And if that were the only thing we were saying, we wouldn't have any kind of discussion going on. But the fact is that there are far more factors that raise questions.
So we've got, somebody's got the mic in back, and then I'm gonna move the other mic to the woman here in the purple dress. Yep.
Hi, I'm a fourth-year student here at the law school and at NYU Wagner, and I was wondering if the panelists could speak
most,
to...
It takes most people only 3 years to get through.
I know. I'm a masochist. So I was wondering if the panelists could talk about to what extent we should rely on the 250s as the measure of whether police had reasonable suspicion at any given stop, or to what extent the response by the defense would be, well, the police were relying on other things that are not captured in these single forms.
I agree.
Before there was litigation, the Floyd case was preceded by another litigation called Daniels. Floyd is a follow-on litigation. But before either of those cases were filed, there were always 250s being filled out by hand and not entered into a database. I think one of the I'm not 100% sure, but I think I'm right, that one of the outcomes of the Daniels case was that the form was revised from asking police to fill out a narrative to box checking. And so the form now, the officer is asked to check a box as to the reason for the stop. And if you examine those forms, it is surely true that some of them, if a form only checks a box which says high crime area, I don't disagree, that's not a sufficient constitutional basis. Whether or not they saw something else is a very hard question. It's not clear how accurate paperwork is in many municipal departments in New York City or elsewhere. And so to have hesitancy about the accuracy up or down of 250s or other documents is a legitimate question. I don't know how often they're accurate or inaccurate, but one should always bring a healthy skepticism to that question.
I mean, I think it's important, you know, whether or not that should be the only basis, I'm not in a position to say, but without it, there is nothing to go on. And, you know, for example, 20 years ago, the idea that there was such a thing as racial profiling was dismissed as being the paranoia of people of color, and it was only in what happened in the New Jersey and the Maryland cases that people realized this is a reality. It's a statistically demonstrable reality. And, you know, in the absence of any records to prove that, then it becomes extremely difficult.
So, yep, and then there's a gentleman in the back with a scarf around his neck who is very patiently waiting. Do you still want the mic? Yep. Okay, he's passing, yep.
I'm David Udell. I'm a visiting professor at Cardozo Law School. And I've noticed recently a story in the New York Times which followed earlier stories in the Village Voice, which suggested that there may be systematic downgrading of felony crimes to misdemeanors, and noting that the police department in New York City is not releasing the data on misdemeanors. And I'm wondering if the fanatical obsession with CompStat could be pressuring senior police officers to pressure other people to downgrade crimes. If that's part of the explanation for the drop.
I just don't think that there's evidence that a significant, at all, a significant portion of the drop is due to downgrading or misreporting. The study that claim is based on by Eli Silverman and Johnny Turno, I think was extremely flawed. It asked captains from the pre-CompStat era and the post-CompStat era whether they were aware of changes in crime reports. Now, it didn't find out if then there was a higher rate of captains in the post-CompStat era that said they were aware. But we don't know how many incidents that represents. Was it, it could have been three highly publicized incidents. More importantly, it didn't ask people who spanned the pre- and post-CompStat era if they saw changes in crime reporting behavior. It may be that the attention to crime data was so much higher in the CompStat era that things became more public. As Dennis Smith has pointed out, there is the auditing functions in the NYPD are practically unprecedented. And nobody has, since Kelly has come in, nobody has been disciplined or fired for a rise in crime on their beat. They have been disciplined for fudging numbers. So every accountability system has the possibility that some people are going to try and manipulate numbers to meet it. That happens in teaching as well. I don't think that that is an argument against accountability. I think accountability has given New York City a crime drop that is confirmed when you look at the National Crime Victim Survey rates, which is independent of police data. It's not the UCRs, it's surveys of people directly asking their crime experience, and that confirms what the crime drop has been.
It's also interesting to point out, again, Professor Zimring, in his forthcoming book, talks about the verification of certain categories of crime rates. And the two that he gives the most attention to, at least at the presentation I went to, the first was homicide, which is obviously independently verifiable through coroner's reports and the medical examiner's reports. And the police data on homicides are more than 99.99% confirmed by coroner's reports and the medical examiner's reports. The second category that he looked at, or at least that he reported on, was auto theft rates, which are independently confirmed by insurance claims and insurance data. So at least for those where you have an external source from which you can verify, he found no inaccuracies, a huge correlation between police reports and externally verified comparable data.
Okay, there's an arm right here, and then if we have time, you've got the last question.
Ed Lintz, 3L. Could this be a little bit solved by limiting the scope of the frisk to the scope of the crime for which the police have reasonable suspicion? So if you suspect someone of going up to an ATM and, you know, robbing someone, the scope of your frisk could only entail looking for a weapon that might be involved in that robbery. If you suspect them of drug dealing and distribution, you could only look for a significant quantity of drugs that would be consistent with distribution. You could essentially never search someone's jeans pocket. If it's a hot summer day, they're wearing a t-shirt and blue jeans, that would be a very short frisk indeed, because you would only have the right to look for a weapon or a significant quantity of drugs.
Well, I should have mentioned as a doctrinal point earlier on, a frisk may not be a search for evidence. It may only be for officer safety. So that absent a reasonable suspicion that somebody is carrying a weapon, no frisk is allowed at all. So that for something where there is no suspicion of a weapon, you may suspect someone is a drug dealer, but unless you have probable cause to search them, you can't frisk for the drugs. So that will that goes a long way to answering your question, because in Fourth Amendment theory, frisks are only for protection of the officers and not for finding evidence. And so that's how I'd respond to that point.
Let's take the last question then.
My name's Katie, and I'm on the lawyering faculty here. You mentioned the statistics based on race for violent crimes like shootings and robberies. But to what extent are Terry stops the vehicles by which police either solve violent crimes or arguably even prevent violent crimes, as opposed to Terry stops being the vehicle by which they address nonviolent crime, even what some may call victimless crimes, simple possessions of contraband, graffiti, and other misdemeanors and infractions? So is there any link, to what extent is there a link between the Terry stop method and violent crime?
Well, my argument is police deployment is based on violent crime. That I think a considerable number of stops now are being generated by the program that I mentioned before, which are impact zones, where the police takes young cops out of the academy, and rather than distributing them proportionally through the city to each precinct, they cluster them in the crime hotspots, the precincts that are having the highest level of violent crime. So that's what they're focusing on. So that means that that's where the cops are going to be densest. And they are out there looking to prevent violent crime. They are making quality of life stops as well. But it is the violent crime rate which is driving the police deployment decisions that are made in one police plaza. And when those cops are there, they are looking for suspicious behavior. And often they are looking for behavior that conforms to a pattern of violent crime that has been broken out, whether it's robberies or shootings.
And I'd say that the violent crime rates are being used as a justification for what are incursions into other basic rights. People are being stopped because they're going into their buildings and they don't have any form of ID, which is not a crime anywhere else. So that whatever the reason for starting the program, in practice what's happening is it causes interventions that are not related to violent crime.
We're out of time. I want to do two things. First, I want to remind everybody next week is the forum on law school exams, so let folks know who are interested in that. And then the week after, we'll be doing the final forum on the filibuster and other issues regarding gridlock in Congress. Second, I really want to thank everybody up here. It was terrific.